Our lecture is regarding heat pumps. So before going on to heat pumps, let us first discuss various kinds of devices. So we are having three different kinds of devices in the thermodynamic systems, which is engine, refrigerator and pump. So just now you have studied regarding working of a vapor compression refrigeration system. So you are already familiar about the refrigeration systems. Basically, the work of these three devices are two different things, means they are grouped into two different groups. First group is the devices which are used to develop work, means work developing devices. So in this category, all the engines which are producing power using thermal energy are categorized in this first category. For the second category, we are having devices which are work absorbing systems. So in the case of work absorbing systems, we are having compressors, refrigerators and heat pumps. So basically, out of these three different devices which I have told you, engine, refrigerator and pumps, engine comes under work developing devices and refrigerator and heat pumps basically are coming under work absorbing devices. Means if we give work to the system and it converts that work into transferring heat from one place to another place, so it utilizes that work, then we are having a refrigerator or a heat pump. Basically, working of both is exactly same. And when we supply some thermal energy to the system and that thermal energy is used to produce useful power in the form of especially mechanical energy, then that device is known as engine. Okay. So as refrigeration and air conditioning are concerned, we are interested in refrigeration and heat pumps. So engines are part of thermodynamics subject, so we would not be taking that. So refrigeration, what is refrigeration? You just now studied that refrigeration basically is the action of cooling and it requires removal of heat. So it should come to your mind that what is the basic difference between refrigeration and cooling. Can somebody tell me what is the difference between refrigeration and cooling? Anyone can attempt? Students, basically what do you mean by cooling and what do you mean by refrigeration? This is what I'm asking about. Okay, if you are not having clarity, let me explain that in the case of cooling, it is just reducing the sensible heat content. When we say sensible heat content, it is referring to the change in temperature. So the temperature must reduce. So whatever is the previous value of temperature for anything which we are talking about, its temperature must reduce, that is known as cooling. And if we say refrigeration, then refrigeration means reducing the temperature below the surrounding temperature. So basically, when we reduce the temperature from a existing value to a value which is lower than the surroundings, then it is known as refrigeration. Otherwise, it will be just cooling. So it means if we are reducing temperature for something which is at, for example, say at 1000 degrees Celsius, we reduce its temperature to 900 degrees Celsius and surrounding temperature is 50 degrees Celsius, then it is not refrigeration. It is simply cooling. But if we reduce the temperature to less than the surrounding temperature, say surrounding temperature was 50 and we have reduced the temperature below 50 degrees Celsius from an initial higher temperature, which would be also more than or equal to ambient or surrounding temperature, means initial temperature should be either 50 or 50 plus if the ambient temperature is 50, and we are reducing the temperature below 50, then it can be called as refrigeration. So it means refrigeration is a subset of cooling. Are you getting this? Students can keep responding. Okay. So some other terms are also there in this slide. You can see chilling and freezing. So basically, the difference between chilling and freezing. Chilling means when we are bringing down the temperature down only, not up. When we are bringing down the temperature means cooling to near freezing temperatures. So what is near freezing? Suppose if the freezing temperature is 0 degrees Celsius, so it should be near to 0 degrees Celsius. So we can say that single digit number temperature can be called as chilling. So bringing material from its initial temperature, say it was 50 degrees Celsius, to 5 degree or 7 degree when the freezing temperature is 0 degree, then it can be called as chilling. Are you getting this? So it has to be near its freezing point. And when we say near, far, less, more, they are all relative terms. So we need to have some limits that how near can we call it as near. Because if we compare some values, say we are comparing, is 5 degree near to 0 degree Celsius as compared to 0.5 degree Celsius near to 0 degree Celsius. So we can say 0.5 degree Celsius is more near to 0 degree Celsius than 5 degree Celsius. So we are required to have some range in mind. Are you getting this? And in the case of chilling, also the rate of cooling should be fast enough. Okay. It should be rapidly reducing the temperature, not slow. Okay. So let me proceed. Now coming on to the heat pumps. So basically, when heat flows from hot body to cold body, a certain amount of energy may be converted into work and extracted, and it can be used to drive a generator. So basically, when we are extracting heat from hot body to cold and transferring it to cold body, basically this is the natural direction of heat flow. Heat always flow from higher temperatures to lower temperatures naturally, and if we employ a device to assist this, then that device can extract some useful amount of energy and it can convert that energy into work. Then that kind of device can be called as a engine. So when we are using this natural cycle, then we are talking about an engine. If we reverse this cycle, so if we go against the natural direction of heat flow, means we are starting from cold body and we extract heat from cold body, making it much more cooler than before, and then supply that extracted heat to a hot body and make it much hotter than before, and doing so will require some work or energy to be input into the system so that this can be done. Because it is against its natural direction of flow, it cannot happen spontaneously or on its own. So it has to be assisted from external supply of work or energy. So such a device which can do this, that it has extracted heat from a low temperature body and supplying it to a higher temperature body, then such a device will be called as heat pump, just analogous to fluid pumps. So what fluid pumps do? They supply fluids from lower pressures or lower heights or levels to higher pressure or heights. So which is against the natural direction of flow of fluids. The same way, if we reverse the direction of flow of heat, then the device used will be called as heat. Are you getting what is heat pump?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so basically refrigeration systems also do the same thing as we are discussing regarding the heat pumps. So what do refrigeration systems do? They are producing cooling effect, and whatever they are cooling, they are reducing its temperature further below its initial value. So it is bringing the temperature down and down and rejecting the heat to somewhere else where the temperature which is initially existing will be supplied with additional heat from the cooler body, and the temperature of that place wherever heat has been rejected will rise, and it will rise more and more with respect to time. So basically the refrigeration system is doing the same thing which I am talking regarding the heat pump. So basically, what is the difference between refrigeration system and heat pump? So here you can see, basically we are having these many differences. First one, performance. So whenever we compare the performance of a refrigeration system, or we judge or evaluate the performance term is called as COP, which is coefficient of performance, and it is the maximum amount of heat from sink with minimum supply of work. So what is sink and what is supply of work? Sink is that body which is required to be cooled. So basically the target of refrigeration system is to produce cooling effect rather than heating the condenser part of it. But reverse is the case with the heat pump. So the target of heat pump is to increase the temperature of the target side or the compressor condenser side rather than to reduce the temperature at the evaporator side. So basic cycle for refrigeration and heat pump is exactly the same. There is no difference. So whatever you have studied regarding vapor compression refrigeration system, exactly same applies to heat pump as it is. The difference comes in the target. The target of refrigeration is to reduce temperature. So we are having evaporator as its objective. And in the case of heat pump, the target of heat pump is to increase the temperature. So our target part is condenser in the case of heat. So this is the basic and most important or the defining difference between heat pump and refrigeration system. And as we are defining the target, so we are defining the output. The output of refrigeration system is evaporator, reduction in temperature of evaporator. Output of heat pump is condenser, increase in temperature of condenser. And requirement of system to work is supply of energy to the compressor for both. So when we say performance, basically performance is output by input. So in the case of refrigeration, it would be reduction in temperature at evaporator divided by the compressor work. So whatever rate of heat transfer is achieved at the evaporator divided by compressor work will be performance of refrigeration system. And for heat pump, rate of heat transfer to the condenser divided by the compressor work or energy supplied to compressor will be its performance. So as we are having different equations or mathematical relationships for performance factors, we are having different names for them as well. So in the case of heat pump, it is called as energy performance ratio, in short EPR. And for the case of refrigeration, it is known as coefficient of performance, in short COP. Now regarding cycle, as I have already explained to you, more heat is required to be extracted from sink in the case of refrigeration, and more heat is required to be delivered to the source in the case of heat pump. For refrigeration, it is used during summer generally, and for heat pump, it is used during winter generally. So same system can act as a refrigeration system in summer, and the same system can act as a heat pump in winter. So it depends on which side of or which component of the system we are targeting. So the term refrigeration is used when the purpose is to extract heat, and the term heat pump is used when the purpose of system is to deliver. So these are some of the differences. Now what are the heat sources for heat pump? So basically, in the case of heat pumps, we require a heat source which will be cooled, some heat will be extracted, and that heat will be finally delivered to the condenser side. So heat sources for heat pumps can be air, water. In the case of water, it can be groundwater, lake water, river water, waste water, discharge water, sea water, etc. It can be earth, means it can be soil itself. It can also be solar energy. And different type of heat pumps can be gas engine driven type, means what is supplying power to the compressor. Based on that, we can have gas engine driven type heat pump, turbine driven type heat pump, solar assisted type heat pump, high temperature heat pumps. So these are some of the types of heat pumps. Now coming on to its working basically. So basically here you can see this figure. Here you can see this figure, reversible circuit, basic principle. You see that with respect to refrigeration system, this type of system is also same. So what we are having it here is a reversible circuit which can be used as a refrigeration system as well as a heat pump. So we are having a indoor unit and a outdoor unit. So here you can say indoor unit and here you can say outdoor unit. Indoor unit, outdoor unit means that evaporator and condenser side. So if we are referring it to say air conditioning system, split AC basically, we are having two separate units. One of the unit is placed inside, another unit is placed outside. So indoor unit is that unit which is placed inside the space which is required to be conditioned, and outdoor unit will be placed in the ambient conditions. Then we are having compressor, then expansion valve, and also along with the expansion valve we are also having this NRVs, which is a non-return valve. And here you also can see the direction of expansion valve, it is also in reverse. And for compressor, we are having this a reversing valve. So basically this, in this reversing valve, here you can see the direction of flow of fluids can be controlled by using this reversing valve. And how it can be used to control this flow is that we are having three lines at the bottom, one line at the top, and in between this valve structure, we are having three different loops or connections. So we are having this slanting connection or slot, another slanting connection or slot, and in between a U-band. Can you see this? Are you able to see this?
Yes, sir.
Students kindly keep responding in between so that I can also know whether I am still online, because there are some network issues at this place. So at the compressor side, suction side and discharge side, we are having this reversing valve connected. So here you can see this side of the compressor has been connected at the top. This side of the compressor has been connected at the bottom. And at the bottom, due to this reversing valve, if this reversing valve switches from this position and this block moves to this end, then what we will be having is this U-band will be connected, connecting these two lines, and this line will be connected from the top side. Means the suction side and discharge side will be switching their direction of flow. And here this direction of flow has been indicated on the compressor. So this direction of flow which has been indicated on the compressor will remain this only. Means this is the discharge side of compressor, this is suction side of compressor. When this reversing valve is in this direction as shown, then what will happen? The compressor is discharging its hot fluid, means refrigerant, high temperature, high pressure refrigerant to the indoor unit, and it will reject heat to the indoor unit, and in this case it is acting as a heat pump. It is heating this space which is in the indoor unit, the conditioned space. Then it will be going through this NRV. So it will be going through this NRV, and then via this thermostatic expansion valve, it will be going to this outdoor unit. So after this indoor unit, after rejecting its heat, this indoor unit will be serving as a condenser. It will be condensing the refrigerant. So it will be in the high pressure liquid near to ambient temperature. Refrigerant going via thermostatic expansion valve. So TEV is for thermostatic expansion valve, and it will be going to this outdoor unit, which is another heat exchanger. It will gain heat from here, so it will become low temperature, above ambient temperature, low pressure vapor. and it will be going via this reversing valve to the suction side of the compressor. So in this case, this indoor unit will be supplying heat, outdoor will be receiving heat. So here you can see these arrows are indicating the direction of heat flow. This is heat flowing into the system, then heat flowing out from the system in this direction. Are you getting this?
Yes, sir.
So in this case, it will be acting as a heat pump. If we switch the direction of this reversing valve, means we shift this block towards this left side, then this U-band will be connecting these two lines and this slanting slot will be connecting this top line towards this indoor unit side. So in that case, as now discharge side of compressor will be connected to this left side, now the high temperature, high pressure refrigerant will go towards outdoor unit. It will reject heat now. So this direction of heat flow will reverse in this case. And then as the direction of refrigerant flow has reversed, it will not go through this thermostatic expansion valve, but it will go through this non-return valve, because these are unidirectional valves. And then it after this outdoor unit, which will be serving now as a condenser, will convert this high temperature, high pressure refrigerant into near to ambient temperature, but at a higher temperature, high pressure refrigerant, and in liquid form. Then it will go via these line and then it will enter this thermostatic expansion valve. So it will reduce the pressure, and by reducing the pressure, now the refrigerant will be in partially evaporated and at a bit lower temperature state, but at a due to lower pressure, it will be ready to be evaporated as soon as it gets some amount of heat. So when it goes via this indoor unit, it will now receive heat and cool the indoor space. So the conditioned space will be now cooled, and then finally it will go towards this suction side of compressor via this reversing valve. Okay. So in this case, it will be working like a refrigerator. So basically all the components are same, and these two diagrams at the bottom side here, you can see that heat pump cooling cycle and this heating cycle and cooling cycle have been indicated in the form of the line diagram. So using same device without changing its orientation or direction can be used as a heat pump or refrigeration system as required, depending on the direction of reversing valve.
Now we will be starting up with analysis of heat pump cycle. So basically the heat pump cycle is same as refrigeration cycle. The basic difference between those two cycles would be that in the case of refrigeration cycle, the temperatures for evaporator would be very much lower than atmosphere, and temperature of condenser would be a bit above atmospheric temperature. Okay, but in the case of heat pump, the temperature of evaporator would be a bit below atmospheric temperature, and temperature of condenser would be higher enough above the atmospheric temperature, because our target in the case of refrigeration system is to reject heat to the atmosphere and cool the evaporator space or the refrigerated space. But in the case of heat pumps, it is to deliver the heat to condenser. Hence our space which has been regulated for temperature will be having condenser as an output unit. So it would be having a much higher temperature than atmospheric temperature or ambient temperature, and the evaporator is gaining heat from the atmosphere or whatever waste heat source of waste heat energy we are having. Okay, so depending on the availability of the heat source, the temperature of evaporator would be near to that source, and our target temperature would be required to be achieved or reached at the condenser side. Now in the case of heat pump, also one more thing is there, as we are having on the output side condenser. So if we can see in this diagram, this heat has been sourced from the heat sink, and amount of heat energy which has been sourced is Q1, and heat pump is taking some work from external agencies. So W amount of work has been taken up, and Q2 amount of heat energy will be supplied to the source. So here we are having reverse direction of heat transfer, heat flow, and also this Q2 would be higher or greater in the value as compared to this Q1. So from this pH chart on this right side, we can see that we are having this Q1 as the enthalpy difference between state 2 and state 1. So this Q1 will be H2 minus H1, which would be lesser than H3 minus H4. And this H3 minus H4 would be the value for Q2. So here we are seeing, if we are required to calculate the COP, which is for heat pump, referred also as EPR, effective performance ratio, so it would be our output, which is Q2, over input, which is this work W. So Q2, as it will be equal to a sum of Q1 and W as per this diagram. So we can write it down as Q2 is equals to Q1 plus W, and by simplifying this equation, we can get that it works out to be 1 plus Q1 by W, and this Q1 by W, this is H2 minus H1, and W is the work supplied to the system, and this is the same relationship as we were using and we have been using in the case of refrigeration system. So we can say that effective performance ratio for a heat pump is 1 plus COP of the refrigeration system. So what does that mean is that always heat pump will be having higher coefficient of performance than refrigeration system. So if the same machine is used as a heat pump instead of being used as a refrigeration machine, then the COP for same machine operating between same temperatures as a heat pump would be 1 greater than the COP when it will be used as a refrigeration system. So in this diagram, you can see that with respect to the condenser temperature, how COP of the system is varying. So if we are seeing that when the temperature TS2, which is the saturation temperature at the condenser, condensation temperature, the value of COP with respect to delta T, which is the temperature difference between the evaporator and the condenser, this can be the ranges of COP. So if we are having this delta T as 10, then we can have this much value or this much range for condenser temperature, and COP will be lying in between this 20 to 30 range. And if we are having larger delta T, means temperature difference between evaporator and condenser, then COP would be lesser, but we can have higher values or higher ranges for temperatures possible. So what we are seeing is, to increase the performance of a heat pump, we should have as low as delta T as possible, means temperature difference between evaporator and condenser should be as low as possible. So keeping in mind this graph, we are seeing that COP is dependent on what factors. So it will be depending on these 3 points. So 1, 2 and 3, the values of H1, H2 and H3, this is what it would be depending on, and these 3 points will be depending on the temperatures existing. So if this TA2, means this temperature which is at this evaporator side, if it is lesser, then what we will be having is, we will be having small length between points 1 and 2, as this trapezoidal shape will be elongated in the vertical direction, top side being fixed, bottom side will go down, and this straight line, horizontal line, will reduce in length. As this temperature reduces, this pressure will also reduce, the graph will go down, and while doing so, the length of this line between 1 and 2 will decrease, and hence the value of Q1 will decrease. Okay, and if we fix this temperature at evaporator and increase this temperature and condenser, same thing again happens. So what we are adding is to increase or but also we must also see one more thing here is that as we increase the gap between these two horizontal lines, this slant line length also increases. This slant line length is indicating the amount of work required to be input in the system. This W, this is the difference between H3 and H2. So if we keep these two lines close enough, less amount of work is required to be input into the system, and with less input, if we can generate some output, it would be having higher efficiency. So that is how COP increases with less delta T. Okay, so here COP comparison, you can see that COP theoretical is given by this relationship, which is TH upon TH minus TC. So TH is temperature, which is heat pump, at the heat pump, then TC is the condenser temperature. So on the Carnot cycle, we can see that on the values of these three temperatures, COP will be having a dependence on. So this is regarding insulation of a cold store. So basically, cold store design we will be covering up later. But coming on to the insulation part, that how the designing or physical construction of cold storage is there. So regarding this insulation, materials which are having lower thermal conductivities are called as insulating material, which you already know, and properly applied insulation will help in economic running of refrigeration plant, because otherwise if we are not applying it properly, then there would be some leakage of heat energy into or out of the system, and hence there would be performance issues. Now, what are the properties of insulating material? Basically, they are having lower thermal conductivity. That is why they are called as insulating material, because the thermal conductivity value is low. Then higher structural strength. Why higher structural strength is required? Because if they are not structurally strong, then they cannot withstand the shapes or amount of material placed on top of each other, and they will crush onto themselves. So they are required to be strong enough to withstand their own structure, at least if not the weight of other materials. Then they should be light in weight, means density should be less, because as in the case of low density materials, the atoms and molecules are having greater space, intermolecular, interionic or otherwise. So they should be light in weight, means regarding density. Then they should have high water repellent properties, because in the case of insulating materials, as we are using them for refrigeration purposes, then we already know that air at every temperature and pressure always has some moisture, and due to presence of that moisture, if we are reducing the temperature, then that moisture can condense, and due to that condensation of moisture, that moisture can fill in the pores of the insulating materials and increase the thermal conductivity, and hence the insulating properties will be reduced. So they should be having high water repellent property. Then they should be odorless, so that they cannot impart any odors of smells to any product which is stored in the conditioned space. Then they should be non-inflammable for safety reasons, and also low cost for economic reasons. Then what are the insulating materials? Basically, we are having these many types, or we can say these many insulating materials, and this is not an exhaustive list. We are having much more insulating materials other than these also. So we are having corkboard, magnesia, wool type insulator, foil, silica aerogel, foam glass, urethane, etc. So we would be covering some of them in details. Now, what is corkboard? Basically, corkboard, for this corkboard, the bark from tree is dried, pressed and baked at moderate temperature. So what we are having as a base material is bark from trees. So bark that is on the trees naturally existing that will be dried, would be pressed and baked, and during this process natural gum of that bark melts, spreads and bind together the entire mass. So we would be having a whole mass together, bind together. The thickness of cork board will be varying from 0.5 to 1.5 centimeters, and it resists the flow of heat because it consists of homogeneous mass of small air cells separated from one another by their own cell wall. So due to this entrapped air, we are having insulating properties. As we know that air which is stagnant is very good insulator, and that is how it is having its insulating properties into the cork board as well. So it is used as a low temperature insulator because it is an organic matter, and at higher temperature it might get ignited. So it would be used at lower temperature. So this is how cork boards looks like. You might also have seen this. Now next one is magnesia. Magnesia is made from light carbonate of magnesia with approximately 15% asbestos fibers added to give strength. So as we had a requirement for strength of insulating material, and magnesia as such is a powder, so it would not be having any structural strength. To give its structural strength, some fibers are added. So asbestos fiber, 15% asbestos fibers are added, and this material after being molded and baked, so it would be molded and then it would be baked. It can be used at temperature up to 300 degrees Celsius because it is not having anything which is able to burn as such at this much temperature. So it can be used at up to 300 degrees Celsius. It is available in the form of slabs, ropes, pipes and also in the powder form. So it is very commonly used in heating systems. It does not mean that it cannot be used in the refrigeration systems. Okay, so this is how magnesia looks like. Are you getting what I am telling you? Students, are you able to get this?
Yes, sir.
Okay, then wool type insulator. Just bear with this spelling, H is extra in the heading. It is WOOL, wool type insulator. So in the case of wool type insulator, we can have various materials. Out of that, one is mineral wool, which is a porous material which traps the air, just like that a cork board. It traps the air, making it one of the best insulating material, and porous and elastic structure of that wool also absorbs noise. So it is having an added advantage that it also absorbs noise. Then we are adding stone wool. So one was mineral wool, another is stone wool. So it is made from volcanic rock, which is a natural material present in large quantities throughout the earth. It combines mechanical resistance with good thermal performance, fire safety and high temperature suitability. Because it is made up out of stone which is from volcanic rock, so it is able to resist fire and higher temperatures. So it is having very good thermal performance as an insulator. Rocks are graded and crushed, mixed with coke and slag, then melted in the furnace at the temperature of 1500 degrees Celsius. So this you can see, just go through this process that how this rock wool is prepared. So here you can see that this factory is showing that how different ingredients crushed are mixed, then they are brought into that furnace, then that furnace is directing that melted material onto rotating wheels where it is spun into wool. So it is spun into thread fibers, so just like wool. Then small quantities of resin binders are added to lock the fibers together, and wool is formed into a mat which is cured and compressed in an oven. Then it is cut and possibly covered with facing material. So it would be then suitably processed. Then glass wool, just like rock wool, now we will be using different materials. So it is sand and recycled glass. So just like that, we are having this spun into fibers. So here you are seeing that at position 3, it has been melted glass, sand, etc. spun into fibers. This wool, then that binding materials will be added. It could be compressed, cured in oven, cut, then with facing material. So this production step you can just go through. Now coming on to the foil kind type of materials, we are having aluminium foils, which is used in as an insulating material. So despite of being made from metal which are known to be conductors of heat, aluminium foils are also used as insulating material. So what are the advantages of aluminium foil is that they are light in weight. How they are light in weight? Due to inherent property of aluminium, that density out of all metals is significantly low, not at the lowest, but it is significantly low. So it would be light in weight, and as we are using it in the form of foil, so various foils will be having separated with air cells. So hence, due to presence of air cells, thermal conductivity will be low. As it is aluminium as a material, it is moisture proof and free from odors. As it is metal, it is having good strength also. Now silica air gel. So the commercial material which is having about the lowest conductivity value of any silica air gel, which is free flowing voluminous solid with 90% air by volume. So here we are seeing that up to 90% of volume is air in this particular material. So it is in practical sense just stagnant in the air around the area which over which it has been applied. So that is how it is having its insulating property. Its conductivity at 32 degrees Celsius is 0.0186 kilocalorie per hour meter square degree cells. So here you can see it is having very very low conductivity value. Here with the spellings, the spellings are a bit incorrect. It has bulk density of 90 kg per meter cube. Material consists of extremely fine pores of sub-microscopic size, so that air cells are very fine. This is how it looks like. So here you can see it is just like cotton fiber. So it is silica aerogel. So it would be very very light. So as the density you can see 90 kg per meter cube. So as if we can compare it with water, water density is 1000 kg per meter cube. Silica aerogel is having density of 90 kg per meter. So it is a very significantly lower in density. Now foam glass. It is a trade name of porous glass block insulation with sealed pore. It is suitable for exterior walls and floors or low temperature rooms on the account of its structural strength. So it is having very good structural strength. Fiber glass, just like foam glass, they are applied to ceilings, walls. It is light in weight, low cost, non-hygroscopic, high strength. Fiber glass reinforced plastics are used in dairies as it is much cheaper than stainless steel. So we can also replace stainless steel to some extent for some of the equipments with fiberglass also. They are used in the temperature ranges of minus 20 to plus 280 degrees Celsius. Then urethane, it is known as a superior insulation in air conditioning industry. So it is very widely used. It is available in the form of slabs, panels, moldings, pipes and liquid that can be poured as well as sprayed. It can be used in this particular temperature range. Here you can see the temperature range very wide on both sides, so minus 200 to plus 200 degrees Celsius. So it is having a very wide range. Now coming on to the vapor barriers, along with insulating materials, we are having a requirement to have vapor barriers also to be installed. Why basically the vapor barriers are required is because without a vapor barrier, warm and moist air which is flowing outward through a wall, ceiling or floor could cool to an extent that some of the vapor would condense out as water and collect within the wall. So what will happen? As soon as wall gets in contact with the air, air is having moisture, and as that moisture cools, air is flowing into the pores of walls. The moisture can condense into the pores of walls, fill those pores with water, and the insulating properties of the wall as well as their structural strength will be having a detrimental effect. Vapor barrier should be installed on the warmer side of insulation and present a continuous impervious surface to vapors pressure from within the building. Why on warmer side? Because on the warmer side we will be having vapor in the vapor form only, not in the liquid form, and if vapors are prevented to enter those pores, it cannot condense into those. But if we are installing it in, on the cold side, then what will happen? The vapors would be able to pass into or move into the pores of insulating material. Then they will be meeting the vapor barrier and they will not be able to cross it. They will be cooling at that location in the insulating material, filling the pores with condensed fluids, and hence the insulating material will be having a detrimental effect on its insulating properties as well as structural properties. So that is why vapor barrier should be on the warmer side. So here you can see that how penetration of moisture through walls can go. So suppose this is outside of building, this is inside of building, vapors will be transmitted through this wall, through the pores, and on the inside we can have some wet surface due to condensation of moisture. So material for vapor barrier include polyethylene film, asphalt coated kraft paper, wax coated kraft paper, aluminium metal foil sheets, and paint coating. So these are some of the materials which can be used as a vapor barrier, and they are required to be applied on the warmer side. So this is how we can apply vapor barriers. So here you can see this is insulation. Here we are not having any vapor barrier. So what will happen? Higher pressure on the warmer side will be forcing the vapor to move in. Why higher pressure is there? Because there is high temperature on outside, low temperature on inside. At higher temperature, higher vapor pressure is there. At lower temperature, lower vapor pressure is there. Due to difference in this vapor pressure, there will be a pressure gradient across the wall, and due to that vapor pressure gradient across the wall, vapors will be moving through the pores of walls, whether it is insulation or any other material. So that is how vapors carrying moisture particles, or we can say water vapors, will be traveling across the wall, and as they are reaching the condensation temperature within the wall or at the side surface of the wall, they will condense and form a film of liquid water. And if they are filling the pores of this insulating material, they are no longer acting as insulating material, and also they are filled with water which is having a very high density. Its weight increases, its structural strength also reduces. So there will be structural damages as well. But what vapor barrier will do? Vapor barrier will prevent any ingress of vapors. So when there are no vapors traveling inside, there will be no such effects as I have explained to you without vapor barrier case. So this is just, you can go through that how these things are there. Just see that polyethylene film, how it looks like, then coated kraft paper, aluminium foil, and how they are applying it. You can also see this part. Now this is how cold store insulation is done. So this, suppose this cold store, then we will be having an inner building material. After that we will be having insulation, then we will be having vapor barrier, and after that we will be having outer building material. So this red colored is building material. So it will be masonry structure, means we can have brick work, we can have cement work, RCC work also. In between we are having this orange colored and black colored segments shown to you differently. So this orange colored is insulation and black colored is vapor barrier. Both kind of materials I have already explained to you.